तो उस पक्षी कृत नीडः ब्रह्मादि भूत पक्षी कृत नीडः ब्रह्मा इज द स्टार्टिंग फेलो हिरण्यगर्भ भूता इज एनी प्राणी द सिंपलेस्ट स्मॉलेस्ट प्राणी इज द भूता एवरीवन हैज मेड हिज ओन हाउस ऑन दिस ह्यूज ट्री प्राणी सुख दुखोद्भूत हर्ष शोक जात नृत्य गीत वादित्र क्षेलिता स्फोटित हसीता कृष्ट रुदित हा हा मुंचे मुंचे अनेक शब्द कृत तुमुली भूत महारावा राइट महारावा यू सी यू हैव ए बिग मेला In the mela, you have all sorts of sounds. All possible sounds are there in the mela. And now, all these sounds together make one big sound. And that big sound can be heard from a distance. Once I was sitting in the room and seeing paper. And so much noise, you cannot distinguish the noise. This is the noise of a person talking. This is the noise of dragging the table. This is the noise of falling the glass on the floor. Like that you cannot distinguish separately. If it is one or two noises, you can distinguish. If there are 100 noises going on simultaneously, how you can distinguish? You cannot distinguish. So all of them together will make one big noise. So like that I heard the noise. And then I opened the door and came out. I saw 10 pillows sitting on that outside and they are making the noise. So much noises, there are so many things in their hands, with them they are making sounds, etc., etc. I came and told, what is going on here? Why you make so much sound? You are making a big disturbance. So then they left. So the idea is, half a dozen fellows come together, and each fellow has got something or the other in his hand with which he makes a sound, and each fellow is talking simultaneously. So like that in a club or in a party or in a mela, you find a huge noises in which you cannot distinguish this is this noise, this is this noise. That type of viveka is not possible. So this is what is called tumula dhvani. In Sanskrit we have such a word for it. Did Bhashyakara use it? Yeah. Tumuli bhuta maharavaha. Tumuli bhuta means all mixed up. No more viveka is possible of individual noises. It has become a one big noise. But then all mixed up means what are all those noises? So Bhashyakara is giving a few examples of those noises. In one place, some fellows are enjoying dance program, nutya. Then in some other place, there is a music concert going on. And then in another place, they are fighting with each other. And They are discussing something. Or they are beating the drums. Then you have kshvelita, asphotita. These are all the words which describe a situation in which people fight with each other, they beat each other, etc. So, kshvelita is a keli vishesha. They are playing, some cricket is going on. So somebody has hit a four. The whole stadium erupts into an ocean of sound. That is kshvelita. Then asphotita. Asphotita means you hit the other fellow with all the strength in your hands. That is asphotita. So that type of big sounds will come. Then harshita. Asphotita. Hasita. So they are laughing. With a loud voice they are laughing. So then some people laugh, you feel as if there is an earthquake. That type of laugh will be there. Then you have akrushta. Akrushta means they are abusing. At the height of their voice, they are abusing. And rudita, the fellows who received these blows, they are weeping at the height of their voice. Then ha ha, that is how they are weeping. And then muncha muncha, mujhe chhoddo, like that. They are waking sounds. All these sounds are there. So what type of sounds there? On one side you have a music concert, a dance drama, and then drum beating, etc. are there. On the other side, they are beating each other, they are hitting each other, and they are killing each other. Maro, maro, like that sounds are coming. Chodo, chodo, like that replies are coming. It is all there. All these sounds are there in this samsara vruksha. It is like so many birds live on a tree, and in the evening they make huge noise. And each bird makes its own characteristic noise like that. And why all these noises are coming? Because harsha shoka jata. They are coming from harsha and shoka. Harsha like nrutya gita etc. Shoka like muncha muncha etc. is the shoka. And then what else are there? Sukha dukkha udbhuta harsha shoka. Where from this harsha and shoka has come? Because a favorable situation is sukha, which gives harsha. And an unfavorable situation is dukkha, which gives rise to shoka. So he has differentiated. Sukha dukkha give rise to harsha and shoka. So sukham has come, therefore they are making a party. Dukham has come, therefore they are weeping. In either case they make noise, a lot of noise. So in the towns, a marriage comes, therefore they put a pandal on the road. This is Hyderabad culture. I don't know in other towns. So the entire road is occupied with the pandal. They dig up the road and put poles and make a shamiana there and put chairs, and you don't find place to go. So if you have a car, then you are down. You cannot make any progress. If you have a scooter, then side by lanes, etc. are there. You can maneuver there and come out of that. So a marriage comes means the entire neighborhood has to suffer. They put a loudspeaker. And then Ganesh, or these Muslim programs, my God, the entire night goes on and on and on. So a fellow who lives in the city, he suffers like anything. That's why people who live in the ashrams, when they go back to city, they find it is very difficult. Unless you live in a reasonably good locality. So I know one friend who purchased a house on a side street, adjoining a side street. He purchased the house. At that time he thought, I made a very good purchase and he is a very happy man. But then in 10 years, that side street has become a main road. Now he sits in his house, buses, lorries, trucks, autos, all sorts of vehicles will be speeding up and down the road all the 24 hours. And you sit in his house, you are disturbed constantly. It is like a huge noise is always there in the house. He wants to get rid of that house. And he wants to go elsewhere. He is not finding a different place where this type of problem will not be there. He wants to sell away that house. He doesn't want to live there. So like this, you have dukkha is there, noise. Sukha is there, noise. This noise and noise and noise. So noise pollution. This is samsara vruksha is like that. So prani sukha dukkha udbhuta harsha shoka jata नृत्यगीत वादित्र क्षेलित आस्फोटित हसित आकृष्ट रुदित हा हा मुंच मुंचादि अनेक शब्द कृत तुमुलीभूत महारावः. दिस इज द संसार. दैट मीन्स दिस सोसाइटी इज हैविंग ऑल एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ ह्यूमन अप्स एंड डाउन्स. दैट इज हाउ द संसार गोस ऑन एंड ऑन. नेक्स्ट वेदांत विहित ब्रह्मात्मदर्शनासंगशस्त्रकृतोच्छेदः. सो इज देर एनी वे आउट ऑफ दिस संसार विद दिस नॉइस? इज देर ए वे आउट? यस, दिस संसार वृक्ष कैन बी कट. हाउ? वेदांत शास्त्र टीचर्स यू ए द नॉलेज इन विच ब्रह्मा बिकम्स वन विद द आत्मा. दैट इज ब्रह्मात्मदर्शनम. Darshanam is Brahmatma Jnanam. When Brahmatma Jnanam comes, then the asakti in the samsarika vastus is gone. Because you are Purnaha. There is asakti in the vastus of the world because there is an apurnata centered upon the person. Because there is something wanting in the person. So to fulfill that want, he has to gain something else. Therefore, that is what is called asakti, attachment. Now he is purnaha, everything is in him,
and the samsara, everything in the samsara is mithya. For such a person, what he wants? He doesn't want anything. Therefore, what happens? Asangata comes. So it is asanga becomes asanga. This asanga means attachment. Asanga means detachment. Very close words they are. So that asangata comes into his hands. He plays a few roles which he has to play. He doesn't overact. He doesn't identify with his roles. So the identification with the roles means it becomes a big problem. So he doesn't do that mistake. And he plays the roles exactly, and he keeps his mind detached from the ups and downs of the samsara. That means that asanga becomes a shastram. And that shastra gives him an opportunity to cut this root, this tree, along with its roots, asanga shastrena drudhena chitva. So all the adventitious roots, etc., are now cut. So he is free from the samsara. So uccedaha esha samsara vrukshaha. So this is the samsara vruksha. This compared with ashvattha, ashvattha, ashvatthavat. So that is the comparison. It's not exactly ashvattha, it is something like an ashvattha. Then kama karma vate rita nitya prachalita svabhavaha. So Bhashyakara has come out with a wonderful comparison with ashvattha in a different way. I have given you some comparisons, but he is giving something different. You examine an ashvattha vruksha, a big tree, the leaves, they are constantly moving. No other leaves of any other tree, they don't move that much as the leaves of an ashvattha vruksha. I don't know what is the reason for it. Probably the stem is a long one, and it is stem is also very weak-looking stem, so small, thin stem it is, not a thick stem, it is a thin stem. Whereas for this banyan tree, the stem of the leaf is very strong, very drudham. Whereas for this, the stem is very weak and very long. And you have a big leaf. It is a system, a very symmetrically designed leaf it is, and it is a heavy leaf. So, and also the leaf being somewhat a spread leaf, so it stops the air which is passing through. Therefore, the air has got a bigger impact on it. So, the stem is lengthy and weak, and it stops a lot of area of the air, surface area is more. So probably all these situations put together make it just suitable to constantly move. These leaves are always moving and moving and moving. They never remain static. You can understand this if you go to an ashvattha tree and a nearby trees and go to them when there is no wind and see the ashvattha tree leaves will be moving. Other tree leaves are static. So even tamarind tree leaves, they do not move. They are static. Every tree is like that, except ashvattha tree. Probably that is the reason why the comparison is made with that tree. Bhashyakara has noticed that point. He says, vaterita nitya prachalita svabhavaha. So this habit of constantly moving because of the wind. So this, the wind causes a movement in the leaves always. This nature is there in the ashvattha vruksha. In the same way, the samsara vruksha has also got this nature, because the fellow is never static. He is constantly moving. He has no relaxation, absolutely unknown thing for a person, because he is constantly impelled by kama and karma. Kama is there, so he has to do karma. Karma creates samskaras, which give a further kama. Kama leads to karma, karma leads to kama. Like that, they perpetuate themselves. They will never end. They continue to be like that. So kama karma rita, kama karma vata. They are the vata. They are the wind. So that wind impels. So impelled by the wind, vata irita. Nitya prachalita svabhavaha. స్వర్గనరకత్రియప్రేతాదిభిః శాఖిభిః శాఖాభిః అవాక్షాఖః. సో ఇట్ ఈస్ హ్యావింగ్ బ్రాంచెస్ స్ప్రెడింగ్ డౌన్వర్డ్స్. అవాక్షాఖః, వాట్ ఆర్ ది బ్రాంచెస్? సో స్వర్గలోక ఈజ్ వన్ బ్రాంచ్, నరకలోక ఈజ్ అనదర్ బ్రాంచ్. సో స్వర్గలోక ఇండికేట్స్ ఆల్ ది జీవాస్ లివింగ్ ఇన్ ది స్వర్గ, సిమిలర్లీ నరక. తిరియక్ లోక ఆర్ తిరియక్ సృష్టి, ఆల్ ది జీవాస్ విచ్ ఆర్ ఇన్ ది యానిమల్ వరల్డ్, దట్ ఫానా వరల్డ్, దే ఆర్ కాల్డ్ తిరియక్ సృష్టి. టెల్ యూ ది సృష్టి కన్సిస్ట్ ఆఫ్ త్రీ వెరైటీస్. వన్ ఈజ్ ద ట్రీస్ హూ టేక్ ది ఫుడ్ upwards. The food flow is upwards. That is the trees. Tiryak means horizontal flow of the food. So the thing, the cow, etc., they eat the food, it travels in a horizontal way. And the downwards flow is human beings. So adhasrishti it is. So the food taken by the fellow goes downwards. So these are the three types of srishti is there with reference to the flow of the food. So anyway, Svarga, Naraka, Tiryak, this is a different classification. In Srishti, that is another classification. The Tiryak word has originated from that classification. Tiryak means horizontally. So Tiryak, Preta, Preta means Sukshma Sharira alone is Preta. There is no Sthola Shariratva. Physical body, Pancha Bhautika Deham is not there. Entirely Vayaviya Deham. It is purely made up of Vayu and Tejas. The type of deham is the preta shariram. So these samuhas of pranis like this, all these samuhas make up different branches of this tree. Sanatanaha anaditvachiram pravruttaha. So it is, they say, this adayar tree, banyan tree, it is there since the last 2000 years like that, they say. So like this particular tree, this Mahavruksham, Ashwatha tree, it is there from the Srishti Adi, Anadi it is. There is no beginning for it. The Bija was there before Srishti. With Srishti the tree has come. So like that Bija, Srishti, Vruksha, Vruksha, Bija, the Mahapravaham goes on. This Anadi. Therefore it is Chirantamaha Vrukshaha Chiram Pravurtaha Yadasya Sansara Vrukshasya Moolam తదేవం శుక్రం శుభ్రం. సో నౌ వి ఆర్ కమింగ్ టు ది మెయిన్ రూట్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ సంసార, నాట్ ది అడ్వెంటిషస్ రూట్స్. అడ్వెంటిషస్ రూట్స్ ఆర్ ఆల్ కర్మానుబంధీని మనుష్య లోకే, దే ఆర్ ది అధశ్చ మూలాన్యనుసంతతాని కర్మానుబంధీని. సో దీస్ అడ్వెంటిషస్ రూట్స్ ఆర్ వేరియస్ కర్మాస్ దట్ యూ పర్ఫార్మ్ and the phala which comes out of the karma. Anubandha means the phala which follows afterwards. So they are the adventitious roots. But the main root, the major root which gives existence, sustenance and life for the tree from which this Ankura has come, that main root will be there. The Ankura will be there, you know. The Ankura grows upwards in the form of a skandha. That the trunk finally it becomes, and the ankura go, the same ankura grows downwards to become the main root, and all other adventitious roots will come later. Therefore, that main root is the Brahma. Like that, you have to see. It is only a comparison. So that Brahma is the root of this vruksha. We have come to that urdhvamulaha. What is the root? Sansara vrukshasya root is a శుక్రం తద్ బ్రహ్మ, తదేవ శుక్రం తద్ బ్రహ్మ. దట్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఇట్ భాష్యకర ఇస్ నౌ టేకింగ్ అప్. సో తదేవ మీన్స్ ద మెయిన్ రూట్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ వృక్ష ఆఫ్ ది సంసార, దట్ ఈస్ శుక్రం. ఇన్ఫ్యాక్ట్ ది వర్డ్ శుక్ర ఇంప్లైస్ ది బీజత్వ విశిష్ట శుద్ధ చైతన్యం. ఇన్ దట్ బీజత్వం ఈస్ దే. వితౌట్ బీజత్వం వై వృక్ష కమ్స్ అవుట్ ఆఫ్ ఇట్. దట్స్ వై ది వర్డ్ శుక్ర ఈజ్ యూజ్. శుక్ర ఈజ్ తేజస్ ఓన్లీ, దట్ శక్తి చైతన్యం. బికాస్ శుక్రం ఈజ్ శుభ్రం ఇత్యర్థ. ద వర్డ్ శుభ్రత్వం ఈజ్ యూస్డ్ టు చైతన్యం అండ్ ప్రకాశం. But then the Shukra word implies a bijatvam also. It has got the bija, the seed. It is having the properties of a seed for the entire universe. So shuddham, what is this shuddhatvam? Jyotishmat chaitanyatma jyotisvabhavam. So shuddham is jyotishmat prakashatam ityarthah, prakashasvarupam. What is the prakasha for this root, molam? That is samsara molam. What is its prakasha? Its prakasha is chaitanya jyoti alone, nothing other than that. That chaitanya jyoti is the prakasham of the samsara vruksham, this samsara vruksha molam, which is the brahma. Tadeva brahma sarvamahatvat. So that molam of the samsara vruksha, which is the shuddha chaitanya swarupa, that is the sarva mahat, that therefore the word brahma applies to it. It is the greatest in the sense that from it the entire samsara is born, and in it the samsara is sustained, therefore it becomes the greatest automatically. And also it is the only truth of this entire samsara vruksha. Therefore in that respect also, being mithya, samsara becomes avaram, being the satya vastu, it becomes param, which is Niratishaya Mahat Brahma. It is Sarva Mahatvam is also with reference to Desha and Kala, Desha Parichedam and Kala Parichedam are absent in it. That is the Mahatvam of that Brahma. Tadeva Amrutam Avinasha Swabhava Muchyate Kathyate. So that is Amrutam also. Amrutam means Avinasha Swabhavam. There is no Vinasha for it. Whereas the samsara vruksha has got a vinasham. Tadeva amrutam uchyate kathyate satyatvat. Why you say that as amrutam? In contrast to the tree of samsara, it is avinashi, therefore that is the satyam. Samsara is the mithya, and hence we call it amrutam. Vacharambhanam vikaro namadheyam anurutam anyadato martyam. So the Brahma is the avinashi, it is the amrutam. The opposite of that, which is namarupatmaka, which is the vikara, which is the karyam. Vikara is the karyam. So that is anurutam. It is the mithya. It is vajarmano vikaro namadheyam anurutam. Anurutam is mithya. This is the satya vastu, and that is the mithya. Therefore, because it is mithya, it is destroyed the moment jnanam takes place. Jnana eliminates it. That is how a mithya is there. Therefore, anyat ato martyam. This anyat, which is different from this tree, which is having its swarupa only in the naman rupa, which is the mithya, and hence martyam. It is vinashi. In contrast to that, the satya vastu is it is avinashi. Tasmin paramartha satye brahmani lokaha gandharva nagara marichyudaka maya samaha. Paramartha darshana bhavavagamanaha shritaha आश्रिताः सर्वे समस्ताः उत्पत्ति स्थितिलयेषु तस्मिन् लोकाश्रिताः सर्वे. दडिति मंत्रम. यू सी द नेकलेस एटसेट्रा आभरणास देयर स्थिति वेयर इज दैट स्थिति इन द गोल्ड. In utpatti they are in gold, in sthiti they are in gold, in laya also they are in gold only. They are never away from the gold. In the same way, this samsara rupa vruksha has got its sthiti in brahmani, tasmin brahmani, paramartha satye brahmani, which is the truth that remains, the analysis of the pramana. So that is the paramartha satyam. Whereas the jagat appears as satyam, you do the, you understand its swarupam, it falls. It doesn't stand. That's why it is satyam, and it appears as a satyam. That's why it is called pratibhasika satyam. Whereas Brahma is the paramartha satyam. It doesn't appear to be present. It is as though Brahma is absent. There is no Brahma, it is only Jagat which is all around you. That is how it appears. So which appears, the Jagat, is the pratibhasika satyam, it has no real existence, it is mithya. And the Brahma which doesn't appear to be there for the eyes, it is the only satyam, because it is the sukshmam, it is the paramam artham, it is not to be perceived by the eyes, etc. And hence it is paramartha satyam. So that in that satya brahma lokah shritah, all these worlds have their existence in that. How gandharva nagara has its existence in akasha. It doesn't exist as gandharva nagara. Its existence is that of the akasha only. In akasha we see gandharva nagaram, so we say Gandharvanagraha akasheshritaha, we say that. Then udakam, that marichyudakam, where it is there? Marichyudakam, marichishushritam. The water which is seen in the rays of the sun, reflected rays of the sun, it is there only in the rays. It has no existence outside the rays. So if you keep away the rays, if for some reason the sun sets and the rays are withdrawn, the udakam is also not there. Beyond the rays of the sun, the water has no existence. It doesn't really exist there. So marichyudaka maya samaha, maya is the magic. The fellow presents a big magic, and only as long as the magic is going on, the things which he shows appear to be there. But the fellow, he puts all his items in his bag and collects his money fees and goes away, then all the items which he has shown, they will not be there. He distributes rupee notes all over. 10 rupee notes to every fellow in the audience, he distributes 10 rupee notes. And they are there in your hand, but then after the magic is over, they are all disappeared. They are not there. So their existence is only as long as the magic show goes on. So the samsara is also like that. All these lokaha, they exist in Brahma till the paramartha satyam is known. That's why how they are seen, what is the basis of perceiving them, understanding them, thinking that they are present, the basis is paramartha darshana bhava alone, avagamanaha. They are understood to be there, they are seen, and they are thought to be true also, only in the absence of paramartha darshanam. Paramartha jnanam, that advaita brahmatmaikya jnanam is absent, till then all these things appear to be there. Such are these lokas, shritaha, ashritaha, sarve, samastaha, they are having their entire alambanam in the Brahma, in all the three times of utpatti sthiti layeshu. Now we have come to the Brahma, started with the samsara, described the samsara as the vruksha. With the help of the vruksham, we have gone to the main root of the vruksha, which is the Brahma, and that Brahma is the shukram, in which alone all these lokas are existing. So it's a good journey, this way of describing this entire universe as a vruksham, and therefore as mithya, it helps the sadhaka in a big way. Beautiful description. That's why Bhashyakara has given a lot of importance to the mantram. So tadu tad brahma natyeti nati vartate mrudadimiva ghatadi karyam kaschana kaschidapi vikaraha. Yeah. So this is a very interesting statement. Tadu natyeti kaschana, whatever vastu it may be, whatever thing it is in this universe, that won't cross or go above or go beyond the Brahma. That is the way. You see, the marichyudakam cannot exist outside the marichi. The maya vastu cannot exist outside the pale of maya, the jurisdiction of maya. Similarly, all these mithya vastus, they cannot exist outside the adhishthanam of the Brahma. therefore tadunatyeti kashchana. You can understand the same thing in a different language. Drushyam sarvam drushyam kadapi drashtaram atithya na gachyati. Drushyam is there, entire drushyam, whatever may be the drushyam. If the drushyam is a room, or it is the town, or it is the entire country, or it is the entire world, or entire galaxies, or entire universe, or even koti koti brahmandas, they are all drushya. Anything which is the drushyam, kadapi drashtaram atithya na vartate. How it can exist beyond drashta? Because its existence is dependent upon the drashta, by the simple nature, by the fact that it is a drishyam, it has to exist in the consciousness of the drashta alone. Otherwise it has no existence beyond that. Therefore, where my consciousness cannot reach, that cannot become a drishya at all. Therefore, it is the drishyam, you say, then it has to exist within the consciousness. So in that way, the entire jagat being drushyam, any part of it can never cross beyond the jurisdiction of the consciousness. Tadu natyeti kashchana. The idea is, sarvam drushyam atma chaitanya adhyastam iti artha. That is the idea, natyeti kashchana. Because the adhyasta vastu, it cannot live beyond the adhisthanam. The sarpam has no existence outside the desha of the Rajju. The Rajju desham is the sarpa desha. The Rajju kala is the sarpa kala. Rajju as a vastu is the adhisthanam for the sarpa as a vastu. So deshataha kalataha vastu tascha, the adhyastam cannot go beyond the adhisthanam. That is the meaning of tadunatyeti kaschana. It's not that so many things are there, they are all jumping inside only, they will not be able to jump this andam. That is not the idea, there is nothing beyond that. So that type of a physical picture it is not. In cognition, everything dissolves in it, nothing goes beyond it. That is the idea. Tadunatyeti kaschana. Advaitata is a very interesting way of putting the Brahma. It is like taking the Brahma through the samsara and finally merging that Brahma into the Atma. So we have started with the Jagat, which is supposed to be away from us. We are isolated and the Jagat is all different from me. Start with that Jagat. Understand its swarupam carefully as a urdhva mula avakshakha vruksha. The analogy really helps you to see that the jagat, the way it appears, it is really non-existent, it is mithya, it is, there is no satyatvam in it. It appears to be so true and so tangible and so solid, but it is nisaram. Its saram is the adhisthana chaitanyam, the asti, asti, bhati, priyam, that chaitanyam alone is its saram. And that chaitanyam is Brahma. Beyond that Brahma, the jagat has no existence. And that Brahma is you. Etad vai tat. So this is what is called vakya bodha in a very unusual way. You see, vakyas, they teach you, they give you knowledge in three different ways. One way is bhedena artha bodhaha, yatha ramena banena hato vali statement. Here Rama is different. Bana is different. Hataha is the kriyapadam. Vali is the person. He is different. So Vali becomes karma. Bana becomes karanam. Rama becomes karta. You see all bheda. Hataha is the kriyapadam which is different. So kriya, karaka, bheda. That is how vakya presents you an understanding in which bheda is the main thing. Ramena, Banena, Hato, Vali. You can add one more word for it. Ramena, Banena, Sugrivaya, Vali, Hataha. Like that, every word you put in that way, it gives rise to jnanam, that vachya tatparya jnanam, in the form of bheda method, bheda method. Then there is another way of putting the vachyam, that is neelam utpalam. Here, the Bheda is not there. It's not that Nelam is another Vastu and Utpalam is another Vastu. It is something different from the earlier Vakyam. But here, Samsarga is there. The Adhisthana in which Nelatvam is seen, the same Adhisthana in which Utpalatvam also is seen. Therefore, Nelatvam and Utpalatvam, though they appear to be different, though they are not one and the same, Nelatvam cannot be Utpalatvam, as Nelatvam is a Gunam, Utpalatvam is the Guni, so that Gunaguni Bhava is there. But then the Samanadhikaranyam, that both having the same Vibhakti, that indicates a sort of Samsarga. So Nelatva Vishishtam Utpala, means Nela becomes the Visheshya, Visheshana, and Utpala becomes the Visheshya. So Visheshana Visheshya Bhava Rupa Sambandhaha is taught there. That is how the Vakyam teaches you the meaning. So this is what is called Samsarga Rupena Arthabodhaha. Earlier we have Bheda Rupena Arthabodhaha. This is Samsarga Rupena Arthabodhaha. Both these methods of teaching are giving the meaning to the other fellow. They fail when it comes to teach Brahma. Brahma is taught in a different way. Not the Bheda Rupena, nor even the Visheshna Visheshya Bhava Rupena. It is taught in the way of Etadvaitat, Tattvamasi, in which there is a Lakshana, a Jahal Lakshana is there, an Ajahal Lakshana is there. So we call it Jahada Jahal Lakshana. So here words, they don't try to teach you a Tatparyam by Bheda method or by the Samsarga method. Both methods fail to teach Brahma. They will only teach you by a Lakshana method. Etadvaitat means, Etat implies, this Atma which is having a Parichannatva Lakshanam, and Tat implies the Parameshwara which is having a Parokshatva Lakshanam. So, these the characteristics understood that way, so these Lakshanas are dropped. So, this is what is called certain as Bhagatyaga, it is what is called. So, certain aspects of Etat and certain other aspects of Tat are dropped. The Parichannatvam of the Etat is dropped. Because to start with how we started, the Jagat is entirely different from me. That is the starting point. So that Parichannatvam in Etat has to be dropped. And that Parameshwara is different. He is somewhere away. He is Paroksha. Now that Parameshwara happens to be the Adhisthanam of this Jagat. Therefore the Parokshatvam of the Parameshwara is dropped. Then Etadvaitat. How it is dropped? The Jagat which is Pratyaksham before you, it has got its Adhisthanam in the Parameshwara alone. Therefore, it is the Jagat as what you are seeing as Jagat. It is not in reality Jagat. It is Parameshwara. Therefore, what happened to the Parokshatvam of the Parameshwara? It is not there anymore. Therefore, Tat you say, but the Tatvam of the Tat, Tat means Paroksha. So, the Parokshatvam of the Tat, the word Tat has its origin because it is Paroksha. It is supposed to be Paroksha. On that basis the word is used. So the basis on which the word is used, that basis is now dropped. The Parokshatvam is dropped. Then Etat, this Etat is the word is used with reference to the entire world being separate from me. That Etatvam, the Parichannatvam, I am something sitting here. This Etatvam, the Parichannatvam is dropped. Then that Tat which is the Chaitanyam, and that is the Adhisthanam for the entire Jagat, and this the Etat is the Parichanna. Though it is perceived to be Parichanna, it is clearly known that it is the Chaitanyam. There is no doubt about that aspect of it. Therefore, the Parichannatvam is only adhyastham on it. As a Chaitanyam, it is understood. Therefore, that Chaitanyam and this Chaitanyam, they become one. This is how the Vakyartha is presented in entirely different style. Therefore, people who fail to recognize how the Vakya functions, they will not be able to come to the truth. So for them, how Etat becomes Tat? It is silly, they are talking, all Advaitins are all talking nonsense. Etat is Etat, Tat is Tat, that is how they say. You see, I would like to give you a concluding remark about this shloka before we disperse for the tea. You see, the Jagat is there, Brahma is there. But then, are they existing separately? Is it that on one side there is Jagat and on the other side there is Brahma?
you have to leave the Jagat and go to the Brahma. Is it that way? Is it that the school and the college and the cinema hall are side by side? Now the boy has two choices. If he goes to the afternoon class, yes, he cannot go to the picture. If he skips the class, then he can go to the class. Is it that way? That is how people present it. Dharma is there, like Vedanta is there, Shastra is there, it is a Mahapavitram, Punyam, etc. What you will do with this Jagat is all nonsense, so leave the Jagat and come to Brahma. It is how they try to understand. But it is a big mistake. It's not that Jagat is existing in a different desha and Ishvara is existing in some other desha. The whole concept is wrong. So Urdhvamoolam Avakshakam, what it does is, this basic fundamental mistake of the concept is wrong and it presents it. What a Dharmashastri will do, you approach a Dharmashastra person, what he will do? He will tell you the karma which you are doing is wrong, or it is a secular karma. It is not a pavitra karma, therefore drop that karma and take up this karma. A new karma he puts in its place. Similarly, you go to Vedanta, so the vision of the Jagat which you are having is all different, it is wrong, therefore you stop looking at the Jagat. You look at something else. Will it show a different padartha to you? It is not that way. The same Jagat you will see, even before coming to Vedanta, after going through Vedanta, you will not be seeing different Jagats. The same Jagat you will see, but then earlier you will see Jagat as Jagat. Earlier you see an Avarana as an Avarana, Naman, Rupa are true in your vision. But after going through the Mahavakya Pramanam, you expose yourself to the Vakya's knowledge, the teaching of this Bhagatyaga Rupa teaching. So then what happens is, the same Jagat you will see, and now you see Brahma as the Adhishthanam of the Jagat, that Karana Drishti will come to it. Earlier you have Karya Drishti, now you will have Karana Drishti. So some of my students told me, sir, after they used to call me sir earlier, now they call me Swami, etc. So they used to sell, sir, earlier we were going to the gold shops and all that, and we were purchasing some jewels, but after listening to your classes, we stopped going to that, because half a dozen ladies were there. Some of them were purchasing some of the ornaments, this and that. But after listening to my classes again and again and again, 1,000 times I should have told them that Avaranam is Vithya and gold is Satyam. This is the only thing you tell day in and day out. So they told, we stopped purchasing all Avaranams, whatever we have. No more Avarana business. So at least I told, okay, Brahma is coming or not, at least this truth you have understood. So that way, Vastu is not changed. It is not that Avaranam is different and gold is different. It is not that. The same Jagat. Earlier also we are seeing the same Jagat. But then we are seeing it as Jagat. Now we see the same Jagat. But now we see it as Parameshwara. I will give you an example. How the seen thing, the thing which is before you, which is seen by you, is the same, but then the attitude towards it is different because the vision is different. You are seeing the same, you are seeing it as Pushpam Adhyastha in Brahma, therefore it is Brahma, that is one vision. It is a Pushpam which is different from me, a part of this Jagat which is different from me, that is another vision. How both visions, this Vastu seen is only one. In whatever form, in whatever attitude I see it, the Vastu seems to be the same. There are no two different Vastus. Therefore, Urdhva Moolam Avakshakam, whether you look at it as a real Vruksham, or Vruksha is Mithya and you cut the Vruksham with cognition and see the Brahma, how it makes a difference? One is a samsara, one is a bandha, the other is moksham. Such a fantastic difference, where from it has come? It has come because of the jnana and ajnana make all the difference. So, I'll tell you an example. There was a princess. So I will close the class with a small story. The princess was married, of course, to a prince. But in Rajasthan, this is a real story. In Rajasthan, the marriage is done to the sword. They do that even a few decades earlier, they were having this system. So the Raja Kumara will be there. His portrait will be, maybe some Chitrakara may put the portrait and give it, but
mostly so and so desha is there, and the king of that particular desham, anga vanga kalinga, like that many deshas are there. Therefore the princess of one desham marries the prince of another desham. There is no other way. They have to marry like that only. So angadesha princess has to marry vangadesha prince. Otherwise there is no match is possible. They won't marry with normal persons. So they marry the prince. The princess marries the prince of another country or another desham or another kingdom. So what happened is, first the marriage is done to the sword of the prince. So the prince's sword will be sent, and the prince will come later. First sword will come, and all the samskaras are all done to the sword, and the princess is married to the sword. Now the princess is a married woman, but yet she did not see her husband. So this husband fellow, he played a trick. What he did is, he came to her kingdom, he came to the capital of her kingdom, and then he took a palace elsewhere for rent, and he was living in it. And he started visiting her antapuram as another prince, not the prince to whom she is already married. She has already married to him. To his sword means she is married to him, but she doesn't know that he is the husband who is married to her. She doesn't know that. She was under the impression that he is another prince of another kingdom. He gave that impression to her. He started making visits, and then he started a creation in which she falls in love with him. This love is a big thing. I come across people who fall in love with each other, etc. In the society you have this problem a lot. So, like this, this girl, she falls in love with him. She is already married princess. She is not supposed to fall in love with another fellow. But then she falls in love with him. Now, she invites him, or he makes her invite him. So he goes. Now, what is he? In her opinion, he is a person other than her husband. Therefore, to tell correctly, the correct word to use against him is jaraha. He is a vitaha or jaraha. And he comes. And then he tells. So she welcomes him inside her room. So he goes into her room. And so she is very happy that the lover has come to her place. Then he tells her, I am not your lover. I am your original husband. Then she commits suicide then and there. Now, what is her mistake? She was all the time having her husband before her. He is not a different person. So, if loving a different person is a sin, then she is not loving a different person. She is loving her husband only. But then, having loved the husband so much, she took such a big risk to meet him. That means she loved him so much. But then she loved him not as a husband. She loved him as a vita. Therefore she committed a mistake. Therefore she has to commit suicide. He will not live with her anymore. Because she is ready to go to another person. So she is a jarini. Therefore he is not going to live with her anymore. He declares it. And therefore she commits suicide. Our situation with reference to the jagat is exactly the same. You forget about this story. Story is only aimed at giving a concept. So you look at the jagat as namarupatmakam and as satyam is there only to give me some satisfaction in terms of vishaya sukhas, etc., etc. You are now doing a mistake with reference to the jagat. It will...